Masechet Karitot, page 24. We are starting at the beginning of Perek Shishi, the last final chapter in this tractate, 6-1, short chapter. And we all familiar with the subject of Jewish guilt. Sometimes we feel guilty, but turns out that we are really not guilty. So obviously we're going to speak hypothetical cases at the time of the Holy Temple, but soon you see is a lot of application and derivative to us. So back at the time of the temple, a fellow brings a provincial guilt offering. It's called Asham Talui. The reason for that is he assumed that he committed a sin. But guess what? The check, for example, the cases we discussed yesterday in the lab, and it turns out that it wasn't a forbidden food, and therefore there is no guilt offering needed in any form. So what do you do now? That fact that the person consecrated that in the serious intent that that should atone for a guilt offering, which turns out that he is not guilty, makes that offering free and nothing, or it carries some sanctity and therefore you have to treat it differently, and many more. So let's start with the Mishnah. Hamevi asham talui venodalo shelo chata. All of a sudden, the fellow bringing a provisional guilt offering, and then it turns out it's free of guilt. He didn't commit it, the sin. Later on page 25, we're going to expand on that. So that's the rule. Im ad shelo nishchat, if all of that happened prior to do the shchita, the slaughtering of the animal, yetze ve'ir'e ba'eder divrei Rabbi Meir. So Rabbi Meir said that that animal shall emerge and graze with the flock as a non-sacred animal. Why? Because the whole idea of consecration was a mistake. V'chachamim umrim, the sages disagree with Rabbi Meir, and they tell us that this new korban, this offering, carries some sanctity, and therefore yir'eh ad she'istaev v'imacher v'iplu damav lindava. So therefore we have to treat it like we have many cases in the previous tractate, if you remember, Zvachin. You leave the animal to graze, and later on, obviously, naturally, the animal develop a blemish, and after it develop a blemish, then by force of circumstance, you sell it, you take the assets, the money that you receive, and you should allocate it for a purchase of communal guilt offering by the temple treasury. In general, we learn, Aruch Laner and others explain to us, in order not to leave Mizbeach Batel, in a sense that the altar is not being used, so it was situation like that, that they bring a voluntarily burn offering from the public. But there is a third opinion. Rabbi Eliezer omer yikrav sheimeno ba'al chet ze, hareu ba'al chet acher. Beautifully. Rabbi Eliezer said, look, it may turn out that a person is free of guilt and is no need for that particular intent to bring a provisional guilt offering. However, we all, knowledge, no knowledge, committed sins. So if it wasn't allocated properly, it can atone for something else, that the person is not aware. But the beauty of that is some Mefarshim explain that it's a kind of optional Sfat Emet in Menachot 102 say that that's basically, in his view, leave it to a person's decision. Anyway, the Mishnah continues. Im mishenishchat nodalo, yishafech adam ve'abasar yeitze lebeit hasrifa. So, if it became known to him that he did not commit transgression, after the ram was already nishchat, and his dam collected in a container, so you take that dam and you pour it into the canal that flows to the temple courtyard. And they said, Nizrak hadam v'abasar kayam ya'achel. So after that, the flesh will go out and to place in the place of burning, like any other disqualified offering. But if the dam was sprinkled before they discovered that he did not commit the sin, so the meal, and the meal is intact, the meat may be eaten by the Kohanim like any other sin offering, because from the moment that the blood was sprinkled, the meat is permitted to the Kohanim. Rabbi Yosei Omer, Afilo Adam Bakos Yizarek Ve'Habasar Ye'achel. So he said, even if the blood is still, was still in the cup, when discovering that he'd not seen, so you have to take it and sprinkle, and the meat may be eaten. Later we explain it. But in general, the idea is kol ha'omed lizarek kezaruk dami. Anyway, asham vadai. So the Mishnah instructed Zvachim, page 54b, enumerated five different a definite guilt offering. So the Mishnah here said, Asham vadai enochen, in the case of a definite guilt offering, it's not the case, which means the halacha is different than the regard to the Asham talui, the provisional guilt offering. If he made a discovery that he did not sin before the ram was slaughtered, Ad shelo nishchat yetze v'yireh ba'eder, it shall go out and graze among the flock, as it's not consecrated. Mishenishchat arei ze yikaver. If it became known to him that he did not sin after the ram was slaughtered, it shall be buried like a non-sacred animal that was slaughtered in a temple courtyard, and the blood is poor. Nizrak adam basar yetze lebet ha-sreifa. If he discovered that he did not sin after the blood was sprinkled, the flesh shall go out to the place of burning, like any disqualified offering. Sho haniskal einochen. So the Torah tells us in Exodus chapter 21, verses 28 to 32, a case of a sho haniskal. You have an ox that the owner, obviously responsible for him, committed such a crime, and as a result, it was sentenced to be stoned, which means that ox, in our modern days, you call it, put him to sleep, because he was he caused to kill a person, and therefore, the din here in Nochen, Shura Niskal Nochen, Ad Shelo Niskal Yetze V'yireh Ba'eder, if it was prior to the ox to be stoned, so it shall go out and graze among the flock, as he never had the status of an ox sentenced to be stoned. However, mishenizkal mutar banai, if it was discovered after the ox was already stoned, so they have the halachic status as though it has not been sentenced, and consequently derive benefit from its neveila, from its carcass, is permitted. Mishenizkal mutar bana. Now the Mishnah dealing with Egla Arufa. I'm assuming that we all remember the Egla Arufa. Obviously we're going to expand on that, but Torah tells us in the book of Deuteronomy, it's so proper, it's just the parsha that we deal this week, but it's Deuteronomy 21. If is a dead body found around the city, and you measure the closest city, and then in their proximity, the closest one, the elders are responsible. And what they do, they take a heifer that they said la'arof ba'nachal, they break the neck. When a corpse is found between two cities and they identify of the murderer is unknown, if it was before Arifa, so it should go out and graze among the flock. It's not mission is ne'erfa, but if it's already done, the neck was broken, tikaver bimkoma, should bury it in its place, like any other heifer whose neck is broken. Shal safek ba mitchila, because that from outset, the heifer whose neck is broken comes to atone for a situation of uncertainty, kipra sfeka v'alchala. If it's atone for its uncertainty, and that uncertainty is gone. B'may plige, what is exactly the disputation among the Tanaim? Rabbi Meir savar kivan de la tzarich lelo makdish lei. Rabbi Meir hold, he initially consecrated the animal with the intention to sacrifice it, since it later became clear to him that he does not require the animal, the sanctity is nullified and is though as he did not consecrate it. Rabbanan Savre mitoch shelibo nokfo gomer umakdish. It's a fascinating Rashi. Rashi said here, quote, shemityare misafek achet shechata. Umaitei aval chatat kevan deashta iglai milta de ba'ir lafreshei lo aval lachatat laetui. Hilkach amrinan misfeka lo akdeshei. So Rashi said, since initially he heard, he has a feeling that maybe he committed the sin. So he has have this conscience over sins that he might have committed. So he wholeheartedly resolved to consecrate the animal, and that sanctity is not nullified. Fascinating. Tana. Ben shenodalo shechata uben nodalo shelo chata. So regardless, if he become known to him that he is seen or not, and the Gemara expanded on that and said, Rabbi Meir v'Rabbanan, plig Rabbi Meir v'Rabbanan, there's a disputation between Rabbi Meir and Rabbanan. Ben nodalo shechata lo deicha kocho shel Rabbi Meir. If it's known for into the sin, to show you the important of view of Rabbi Meir, the afal gav the yada v'chata, that even though he know at this very moment that he is sin, and therefore he must bring a sin offering, and is no longer obligated to bring and to sacrifice the provisional guilt offering, nevertheless, כיוון דבעידנה דאפרישי, it's a different version, לא ידע, תצא ותראה בעדר. The time that he designated the animal as a provisional guilt offering, he wasn't aware, so the animal should go out and graze among the flock, as it is unconsecrated. ובנודע לו שלא חטא, והודיעך כוחן דרבנן, דאף על גב דלא חטא, כיוון בעידנה דאפרי שלו ידע, ליבו נוקפו הווה, הלקח גמר ומקדיש. That's the reason why he wholeheartedly resolved to consecrate the animal. Now the Gemara brings a situation that Rabbi Meir agreed with the sages. אמר רב ששת, רב ששת said, מודה רבי מאיר לחכמים, רב מאיר concedes to the sages, page 24, במפריש שני השמות לאחריות ונתכפר באחת מהם. You have a case that one designates two provincial guilt offerings from the outset as a guarantee, so that if one is lost, he may achieve atonement with the other. דשני יראה עד שיסתהב ועם אחר ויפלו דמיו לנדבה. So the they left the second one out to graze until later on it developed a blemish, and then it sell it, and the money will go for communal guilt offerings. My Tama, what's the reason that Rabbi Meir agree in such a case? So, Ad kan lo pligi Rabbi Meir alehon de Rabbanan. It's Rabbeinu Gershomi. Ad kan lo pligi Rabbi Meir alehon de Rabbanan, ela mishum de lo gale de ate de libonu kfo. Because up to this point, he did not initially reveal his heart that was striking him with the pange of conscience. אבל לחם מקדיר חדו די בילה להפרושי, מי תמה אפרש טרי. But here in a case where he set aside two animals as a provincial guilt offering, since he was required to designate only one animal, so the question is, what's the reason that he is designated two? So evidently the reason is the savar, because he hold אם מרכס חדה מקפרנה בעידה חברי, if one of the animals is lost, he figured out, I will achieve atonement with the other one. וכיוון דגלנה דעתה דלגבון וכפו היה, הואיל וכך היה גמר וקדישו. And since he revealed by his such a scrupulous behavior that his heart was striking with the pungence of conscience, since that's the story, he wholeheartedly revealed to consecrate the animal. אמר רב יהודה, אמר רב מודים חכים לרבי מאיר, באשם תלו שהוזמו עדיו, דייצא ויראה בעדר, מי תמה. So he said, רבי יהודה said to רב, the sages concede to רב מאיר when you have a provincial guilt offering, where the two witnesses testify that someone may have committed a sin, which means that he ate piece of fat with regard to which there was uncertainty if it was permitted or forbidden fat. And later those witnesses were rendered conspiring witnesses. So the animal shall go out and graze among the flock as a non-sacred animal. My Tama, the reason? Ad kan lo pligi Rabbanan alei. Up to this point, the sages do not disagree with Rabbi Meir, only with the case. אלא אחד האפרישה על פי עצמו, ואמר, ואומין לבונו כפו, because he himself did it, the consecration, and we said it may hard pungent of conscience. אבל אחד על פי עדים אפרישה, but only in the case when you have as a result of a testimony of those witnesses, and that's the reason why he set aside the consecration of that animal, לא הווה סמוך אילווה די העדים, he was not relying on the witnesses, rather, he thought, perhaps, other witnesses will come and render these witnesses conspiring witnesses. The savar din ma'atu achim mezamelu. Mativ Rava. So Rava challenged him from our Mishnah. Shura niskal, as we learned earlier, ox that sent two sentence to stone. Im ad shelo niskal v'yirtze v'yiret ba'eder. If it was prior, it did not stone yet, so we leave him to graze. Hey Chedame, what is circumstance you talk here? Ile madatu beit reva amrei harag. If you have two witnesses that come and say this ox killed someone, uveit reva amrei lo harag, and the other two witnesses said it never did it. Mai chazid de tzayt lebatrai. What's the reason that you go and listen to the later pair? Tzayt lo lekamai. You should listen, just listen well to the former, the original pair. El alav bede azama. You have to say, speak that this is conspiring witnesses. The second one, that dechvatei gabei hasham talui. So you talk about provincial guilt offering. It is likewise referring to conspiring witnesses, which means Bezaz Maufligi, one designates an animal as a provincial guilt offering due to the testimony of witnesses, and then were subsequently proven to be conspiring witnesses. And the sages agree with Rabbi Meir in a case and rule that this provincial guilt offering is not rendered non-sacred. Amar le Abaye v'dilma shon iska lechidam kigon sheba arug beraglav. So you have this rare case where the supposedly killed individual comes to court on his feet, which means that it's conclusively proving the testimony. With dechvatei gabei hasham talui, the same apply to in the Mishnah over a provisional guilt offering. He's referring to a case when one designates an animal as a provisional guilt offering of his own volition. And for example, going to hukra chaticha, it later became known that the uncertain piece of fat that he ate was permitted fat, אבל היכא דאפרישי לה, שם תלוי על פי עדים לא, but when he set aside, consecrated by the those testimony of witnesses, he did not wholeheartedly resolve to consecrate the animal, and therefore it shall go out and graze among the flock. So the Gemara notes that Rabbi Yehuda and Rava, who discussed the case of conspiring witnesses, disagree biflugta, disagree with regard to issue that is the subject of the dispute between Rabbi Elazar and Rabbi Yochanan. Asham talui shehu zmuedav. So you have here a situation of provisional guilt offering due to the testimony of witnesses, and then whose witnesses will render conspiring witnesses. Rabbi Elazar omer acharei kiminkhat knaot, says it treated the same as the offering of jealousy that the Torah talk in Parashat Naso in Sotah in Book of Bamidbar, Numbers, chapter 5, verses 25-26, that sacrifice as part of the trial undergo by a sotah, which is the suspicious adulteress, and is taught in the Braita, the Tanim Tzu Edea Zomemim El Chatat Etzel Achulin. So if it turns out that those people who lied to court, and she wasn't involved in adultery, so therefore that Korban Milcha, that meal offering, transferred to a non-sacred status, in the same way, when you have a provisional guilt offering, whose witnesses was were proving to be conspiring witnesses, become non-sacred. Rabbi Yochanan said that he left the animal to graze until it became a blemish, and then you take the money, you sell the animal, take the money, you give it as a voluntarily a communal guilt offering. The Gemara raised a difficulty, however, Rabbi Yochanan idamel le minchat knaot, why we don't juxtapose, why we don't compare it to the adulterous meal offering, the same way as we said earlier, it's not comparable. Why minchat knaot lo lecha kapara kaita levarei ravon? The only reason that you bring this special meal offering for the husband who suspected his wife to be unfaithful is in order to clarify that there's not iniquity involved in this. Versus here that is talk about kapara, about atonement. Aval asham talu de kaparate, but because this pendable, this provisional guilt offering, the purpose is solely and only to atone, mitoch shelibo gonofo gomer umakdisho, because as we said, his heart strikes with the pungence of conscience, he wholeheartedly resolves to consecrate the animal, and therefore it remains sacred. Amar Rabbi Krus Pedai, Amar Rabbi Yochanan. Krus Pedai, by the way, is a Greek name, related to the Greek word kruspedon, meaning edge or border. In this context, the word refers to ritual fringes, the tzitzit, as a name, kruspedai, is equivalent to the Hebrew word tzitzit, which appears as a somehow in other places. But anyway, Amar Rabbi Krus Pedai, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Shor HaNiskal Shehu Zmuedav, Kol HaMachzik Bo Zacha Bo. So you have an ox, a sentence, and then it turns out that those witnesses are lying, and they're conspiring witnesses. So what do you do? Whoever, anyone who take possession of the ox, acquire it. As the owner of the ox relinquish his possession upon hearing that the animal is sentenced to die. Amar Rava Mistabra Tamad Rabbi Yochanan Kon Amre Le Nirba Shoro, Aval Amru Rava Shoro, just the opposite. Who b'asmo midai adad lo rava velo mafkar le betarach umayit edim. So he knows that he's not engaged in bestiality, therefore he will not relinquish his ownership, but rather he will make an arduous effort and bring other witnesses to prove that those witnesses are conspiring. Umayishna mehada amar rava bar iti amar reish lakish ira nidachat shuzmu yodea kol amachzik bazacha. What's the difference between what the Rabbah Bar Iti said, name of Reish Lakish, if you have a idolatrous city where witnesses testify that the majority of the inhabitants committed idolatry, and the halacha is that all of the city property must be burned, kol amachzik bazachaba, if witnesses was rendered conspiring witnesses, anyone who's taking possession of the city's property require it. In this case, the residents of the city know about themselves that they did not commit adultery. Ira nidachat rabim nidu. So he said, when it's come to this type of ira nidachat idolatrous city, which is involved with many people, kol chad amar bedate, ana lachatai, acharin achatai, umafkar mamuna, everyone said, I did not commit a sin, he did it. and therefore, in a way, they relinquish ownership of their property. But here, it's the solely upon the owner himself. He knows about himself that he did not engage in bestiality. So therefore he's not relinquished his ownership, and he make an arduous effort to bring in witnesses and to prove that he didn't do it, and it's the ownership of the item is not relinquished, and the ox remains in the possession. If a fellow gives a gift to another one, and the person receiving the gift said, "I don't want it," anyone who takes possession of the item acquires the ownership of the item has been relinquished. One who received a gift. After the gift entered to his possession, he said, "Let this gift become void," or said, "This gift is rendered void." Mevutelet if shiba, or he said, "I do not want it." Dvarav kayamim, his sentence is effective. So, however, if he said beteila, it is void. Eina matana, it's not a gift. It is as though he said nothing. Lo amar klum. Some said the girsa dvarav kayamim. The shar mishpat in Reish Mem Hei expand on that. You see also in the Rashba, based on Rashi here, expand on that. Page 24b, the Gemara concluded its question, "My love dvarav kayamin." Apparently, his statement is effective, which means the hadra lemarei, that the gift returns to its previous owner. So that's basically the opposite, it's contradict to what Reish Lakish said, that in a case where anyone who takes possession of the item requires it, and the Gemara answered, "Lo, dvarav kayamin, vehunam elokan elei v'chol amachazik bazachar." So his statement is effective, and he also not acquired the item, and therefore anyone who takes possession is zachar, so it's acquired it. V'chol amachazik bazachar ba. Now, there are few, the Rashba and few others have a different avenue to understand. Those who can have the time should go by and read Maim Kedoshim, Chok Natan, and other Mefarshim that expand on this sugiya a lot. It's a few girsaot. You see Beit Abad, Rabbeinu Gershom, several girsaot. Meiti ve'omer lechavero din dvarim en li al sadeh zot, en li esek ba, yevyadi mesuleket mena lo amar klum. So all kind of statement, they said, "I have no legal dealing or involving with the field, I have no business of it, my hand is removed from it, I have nothing meaning he's not... he does not relinquish his ownership of the property, but the phrase "va'ayadim esulaket emena ke'i efshar dame v'ktanu lo amar klum." So they say that anyone who takes possession of the item is required. Shane'atam, over there is different. Kisalik nafshei, because when he said that he is removing himself, he's referring to removal from legal dealing or involvement. But he's not removing himself from the field itself. Meitivei. This is a well-known sugiya, and it challenged here the ruling of Reish Lakish. Ha'omer lechavero, there are two partners in the field. One said to the other, "I'm sorry, meitivei, akutev nechasav le'acherim." One is shchiv mera, which means someone who, as Rashi explained, that is about to breach, is very close to the end. That's the way the drisha in Choshen Mishpat Reish Mem Hei explain. Keter Yeshua, again, a different view, but anyway, kotev nechasav l'achrim v'hu b'hem avadim, v'amar ala e efshir b'hem. Doesn't want, "I haya rabo sheni kohen ochlim betruma." Rabban Shimon Gamliel omer, "Kivan shemar yefshi bahem, kvar zachu bahem yorshim." If he said, "I don't want them," the previous owner, heirs, children, or whatever the heir, already acquired them. Bishlam al Rabban Shimon Gamliel kasavar ki yayv inish matana, adata dem kablim b'nei. According to Rabban Shimon Gamliel, he says that when a person gives a gift, it is with the intention that the other person will accept the gift from him. And consequently, כי לא מקבלים למידה, יהדרה למראה. If the individual does not accept the gift from him, the gift returns to his previous owner. אלא לתנא קמא, כי אמר, אי אפשי בהם, וכל המחזיק בהם זכה בהם. הדאמר שני, the second one said, אי אפשי בהם. I don't want them. הבו לו זרים, וכך לזרים תרומה. So you mean to say that the non-priest can are partaking of תרומה? So the Gemara answers, כסבר היהול, המפקיר עבדו יצא לחירות. If one release, renounces ownership of his slave, the slave is emancipated, but nevertheless, וצריך גט שחרור מרבו, he require a build of freedom from his master. וכסבר מעוקב לגט שחרור, אוכל בתרומה. If someone who's detained from receiving a גט שחרור, so may be partake of תרומה if he is the slave of a Kohen. רבלי הזה אומר, יקרא, השם תלוי על המזבח וכולי, שימינו בעל חטא זה, הרי הוא בעל חטא אחר, לרב אליעזר למה לי חטא? According to רב אליעזר, why should be sacrificed for, as a provisional guilt offering, as if he does not come to atone for a sin that he thought it come to atone for another sin, אמר רב אליעזר, so why he need another sin? השם תלוי בנדבעתי, נתן רב אליעזר אומר, מנדב אדם השם תלוי בכל יום, a person anytime he wish to בכל עת שירצה, he can voluntarily bring a provisional guilt offering anytime. אמר רב אשי, רבי אליעזר אמרו, לא הוא, דתנן, אלא אומרים לו, המתן עד שתיכנס לבית הספק, that's the Mishnah on page 25. They said that wait until you enter a situation of a potential uncertainty so that the provisional guilt offering is brought for some sort of uncertain sin and does not offer it purely as a gift offering. So we said im mishen nishchat, the Mishnah said im mishen nishchat nuda v'chul ketan ya basar yetzel lebet asrefa, the flesh will go out to a place of burning. So what you see here, that according to opinion of the Tana of the Mishnah, al machulin shenishchatu bazra, if you have non-sacred animals that were slaughtered in the temple courtyard, such as provincial guilt offering, that was mistakenly consecrated bisrefa, they are going to burn. V'ramini, there raised a contradiction. Asham v'dayeno ken. The definite guilt offering is not like that. Im ad shelo nishchat yatzev rei be'eder. If it's prior, it's not slaughtered yet, you can go and graze among the flock. If it become known to him after the ram was slaughtered, that he did not sin, mi shenishchat harei ze yikaver. He should be buried. So you see indication that non-sacred animals slaughtered in the temple courtyard are burned. אמר רבי אלעזר, תברא מי ששנה זו, לא שנה זאת. רבי אלעזר said, this Mishnah in a way should be divided, meaning that it's kind of contradiction, סתירה. And you have to say that one who taught the first Torah, it's like saying that you have opinion of two different sages. So he who taught this halakha did not teach the other halakha, which means this, the one who, the sages teach the first halakha in regards to definite guilt offering when you have an unsacred animals that's slaughtered in a temple courtyard, they need burial. And the other one, the other sages that have the second one that's talk about Hashem Vadai, the definite guilt offering, he hold that chulin shenishchatu bazra, if you have non-sacred animals that were slaughtered in a temple courtyard, they require sreifa, they require burning. רב אשי אמר, רישא דקטני באשם תלוי. רב אשי said that the first clause, which teaches that with regard to provincial guilt offering, והבשר יצא לבית השריפה, and the flesh will go out to the place of burning. לא קשה, it's not an issue. Its flesh is not treated like that of a non-sacred animal that was slaughtered in a courtyard, which must be buried. משום דמתחזק כזבח פסול, because it's ostensibly appear its appearance of a disqualified offering. Disqualified offering must be burned. So this reason applies equally to the case of a definite guilt offering, where it becomes known to him that he did not sin after the blood was already sprinkled, which is why it too much to be burned. However, if he discovered that it was not designated to bring the definite guilt offering, after the ram was slaughtered, but before its blood was sprinkled, it shall be buried. So it's not appear like a disqualified offering, since it is no longer a definite guilt offering, and its blood was not sprinkled. Mishum demitchazei kezevach pasul. The Mishnah teaches us when it's come to the one who brought provisional guilt offering, nizrak adam habasar yachel. If the blood was sprinkled off the provisional guilt offering on the mizbeach on the altar, so the meat may be eaten by the Kohanim. So the Gemara asks, where am I? Why? Ha havali idea. After he is not certain knowledge of his sin, and the provisional guilt offering is brought only by one who is uncertain about his sin. They said in Leviticus chapter 5, verse 18, and he knows, he knew it not, and he shall be forgiven. So it means that this person did not have knowledge of his sin at the time of forgiveness, when he achieved atonement, which is the moment of the sprinkling of the blood. Rabbi Yosef, Rafilu Adam Bakos Vehule, Rabbi Yosef Maizarek. Ahavi Lady Abishat Slicha, Amarav Rabbi Yosef Savala Kerabi Shimon, Amar Kol Omed Lizarek Kezaruk Dame. That's what we said earlier, that the halachic status of any blood that he received in a vessel is already to be sprinkled, like that blood that has already been sprinkled. Amar Adamar Rabbi Shimon Vimide, De Omed Lizarek Avalaid, En Omed Lizarek. Abel Marov, what they said in Eretz Israel, כסבר רבי יוסי, כלי שערת מקדשים בו את הפסול, בתחילה לקרב. In ארץ ישראל, רבי יוסי hold that the service vessel will consecrate disqualified offering to be offered on the altar, and that's obviously only לכתחילה. And there is a תוספות here, in טהרת הקודש, שפת אמת, נר תמיד, and many more מפרשים. We don't have more time, but maybe another time we expand on this.